नमस्कार, गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीवन। और टुडे वी आर रिमेम्बरिंग विदुषी शांताराव जी, पद्मश्री एंड संगीत नाटक अकेडमी अवार्डी विदुषी शांताराव जी, एंड वी हैव पद्मश्री संगीत नाटक अकेडमी रत्न डॉक्टर सुनील कोठारी, वेल नोन डांस क्रिटिक। वेलकम सुनील जी। एंड वी ऑल्सो डॉक्टर वीना मूर्ति विजय, शी इज अ कुचिपुड़ी एक्सपोनेंट एंड डायरेक्टर ऑफ BIAF बेंगलुरु। वेलकम टू द प्रोग्राम। एंड मे आई रिक्वेस्ट सुनील जी टू गिव द ओपनिंग रिमार्क्स।
या फ्रेंड्स, इट्स अ ग्रेट प्लेजर। थैंक यू गायत्री जी फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस वंडरफुल डिस्कशन बिटवीन मी एंड वीना मूर्ति जी, बिकॉज शी न्यू ऑल्सो शांतारा वेरी वेल। इट वॉज इन 1958 For the first time I saw Shantarao in Bombay at the Lenin College. He was presented by Damu Jhaveri of Indian National Theatre, and she was to present both Bharatanatyam and Mohiniyattam. I heard of her when I read the magazine Marg, in which along with Bharatanatyam dancers Rukmini Devi, Bala Saraswati, Chandra Lekha, Roshan Pradipdar, her photograph was also mentioned, and under the line that Dr. Mulpraj has written, that her dance was rather masculine because she had studied Kathakali in the beginning at Kerala Kalamandam. I am told that it was in Thrissur in 1940 that she had given her first performance of Kathakali, under whom she has turned from Ravani Menon. And before the Nambudri, she presented her Kathakali in 1940. In 40, later on, she went to Sri Lanka where she studied Kandyan dancing. And I am told that it was in 1942 that she presented her Bharatanatyam debut at the Music Academy in Chennai. She was a multi-talented dancer. She knew painting also, and because she studied Kathakali, she used to draw a lot of paintings of Kathakali artists also. And when she ultimately built her own bungalow and what I used to call palace in Malleshwaram, she had number of paintings of many of Kathakali on her wall also. Now Shanta was a very unusual person. She was from Mangalore and from a Saraswat Brahmin family, but they were in Bombay when the civil disobedience movement of 1941 was on in Bombay. She was a very dynamic woman and leader of the students' union, and she used to attend the meetings which took place in her house in Bombay, where there were lots of poets, painters, writers, musicians, freedom fighters used to come, and she used to listen to it very well. So she had become very politically aware at that time and was very anxious that we should achieve our Indian independence. When she went to Kerala Kalamandalam, she learned Kathakali under Ravani Menon and Mohiniyattam under Chinnamma Amma. And because she began with Kathakali, her training was very harsh. It would appear to us very different, as we are going to show in the discussion, the way she performs Alariku, and we'll compare it with the girl, student of Veena Murthy Vijay. But it was absolutely mesmerizing when she appeared on the scene. When I saw her in 1958 in Bombay, I was under a spell. She was like a queen. Her taste was immaculate. Ornaments, armlets, bangles, jewels, hair ornaments, and the saris and all, you can't believe. She looked like a queen. When she came, she cast a spell on everybody. And like a Mohini, when she danced in Mohiniyattam also, it was impossible to take your eyes off. I have written somewhere that when I watched her the first time, I couldn't take my eyes off. But there was a little discomfort also because I had not seen anything like that. She was a contemporary of Chandralekha, Rukmini Devi, Arundel, Bala Saraswati, Mrunalini Sarabhai, U.S. Krishna Rao, Ram Gopal, all those people who have studied Bharatanatyam under Meenakshendra Pillai. But her style looked very, very different to me. However, that doesn't mean that I did not enjoy it. I enjoyed what she danced, etc. But to us, to the contemporary people who have seen dance by, say, Vaidyanathi Mala or Indrani Rehman and other people, Roshan Pradipdar, Kamala, Yamini Krishnamurti, her Bharatanatyam was totally very different. And she took great pride in that. She learnt also Kuchipudi, what she called Bhama Sutram, Bhama Natyam, because if she had studied from Venkatachalapati Sastri, Bhama Sutram, on that base, she had called it Bhama Natyam, but she had studied Kuchipudi with Venkat Kinasatyam. And she was extremely fond of reading books. She had a fantastic collection of books from one of the booksellers on the Brigade Road in Bangalore. She would go there and buy the latest book also. Now, luckily, those books have gone to Kalakshetra Foundation. So okay. All the books are preserved. Her costumes are preserved. I don't know about her exactly, the golden ornament, because she had a fantastic collection of ornaments, etc. where they are. But I'm sure the trustees have taken care of, etc. Shanta, when after she made her debut in 1940 in Windsor with Yehudi Menuhin, who invited her, there was another great impresario by name called John Coast. And he used to present Kamala Lakshman and many other dancers in America and London, Paris, New York. She traveled. She was in Israel. She was in Germany. She went to Nepal. She went to Japan and many places. And wherever she went, definitely, the reception was very great. I do remember that when she performed in London, and the great dance critic by name Arnold Haskell, he wrote wonderfully about her, that her movements were like the blows of a steel and as silken as the silk. Now, these are contradictions, but that definitely the way she made an impression of what the Western company, Western ballet people and all was marvelous. Now, when we come back to her, the book which is written about her in the Dance of Golden Hall by Ashok Chatterjee, who was the former director of the National Design Institute in Ahmedabad, and he wrote this book. And the another book written on her is about by a Dutch writer called Beryl Dessert. The other mind is a full chapter on Shanta Rao. And one book which is written is by G. Venkatachalam. A chapter on her is in Dances of India. And one booklet, small, is written Srimati Shanta by G. Venkatachalam, who was her friend, philosopher, and guide. And he would take her everywhere. He would take care of her performances, presentation, etc. When Shanta became very well known after her tours abroad, etc., she decided later to settle down in Bangalore and in the Malleshwaram on the 8th road. Her institution was called Shanta Rao Center for Arts. And that is where I had gone much later on. You know, it's a very sad story that when she died on the 20, I've written the date about her departure. She passed away on the date was something in December, 29 December, she passed away in Bangalore. I was in Chennai, but when I came back to Bangalore later on after 2 months, we thought we should go and see what happened to her, where is her place, what is her institution like. And we were also told that her institution was already taken away by one realtor and landlord, a person who was looking after her land, and that it was turned into a small auditorium for reception, slideshows, etc. She had built a small theater. Like this is the one, you know, the Shanta Rao, it is Center for Arts. And that it was later on turned into, now this was the reception room where you have reception. This is me and my friend Satish. We are gone under a pretense to book the auditorium because nobody was allowed to go and look at the places what she had. This is the, you know, sequence where she used to have performances with a 250 seat of auditorium. As you can see, number of seats over there. And there used to be a private show. I'm told that the last show she had given in Bangalore was in 2006. And at that time, all the dancers from Bangalore had come. Ram Gopal, who was her contemporary, he had also come. Ram Gopal also came and watched her dance, etc. And Shanta was a private person. She did not like anybody recording her film. We are very lucky that when she danced in 1940 in Windsor for Yehudi Menuhin, the great violinist, he, as we see in the film, is introducing her. We have some recording of Alaripu and one Padam also. And then, thanks to Ashok Chatterjee, we have got the recording of BBC film, where we see some section of Bharatanatyam. Also, we see a section of Mohiniyattam also. And Mohiniyattam is very forceful. Whatever she learned from Chinnamayam and all, even then, the presentation was so powerful that you can't your teeth's eyes observe. She was one of the best Mohiniyattam dancers in those years. And then later on, many other dancers were also, but other dancers were performing only a item, two or three items of Cholukettu and all in Mohiniyattam after, say, Bharatanatyam or Odissi or anything. But she was performing Mohiniyattam in solo performance also. One of her big, beautiful performances on Ambapali, that is Amrapali, the, you know, the dancer of Partizan of the Bimbisar. Now, I want to bring Veenaji into the picture. Veenaji used to help her in the morning breakfast. She was very fond of Veena. When Meenaji was 17 years old, when she went to study, she said, "Oh, no, no, I don't want to teach you. You'll get married and afterward you will have children, you won't come and dance anymore." But now that Meenaji speak about her contribution and everything. She was a very great friend of Shantaji. Shantaji used to talk very highly of Meenaburthe. Acha, Meenaji, aap bataiye.
Yeah. Meenaji, kindly unmute yourself.
Thank you, Jayant Garu, Jayavant Garu. It has been a great opportunity and a great blessing for me that I'm sharing certain beautiful memories from my books or the pages of the past. And Sunil Bhai, thank you so much for thinking of me. It's really nice. It's very heartening to share these beautiful memories. Actually, I could say that Shanta Rao ji is my Manasa Guru. Because I was only about 6 or 7 years old and I didn't know anything about dance. My friend Geeta happened to be the daughter of an income tax commissioner. And Shanta Rao ji wanted certain income tax papers and things like work to be done by him. And my father and the income tax commissioner then were very good friends. So at that point of time, Mr. Krishnan was his name. He was a commissioner and he was a great connoisseur of arts. And he was very interested that his daughter learned from Shanta Rao ji, because at that point of time, there were very few dancers in India, and women took to dancing, and the proscenium stage dancing was slowly evolving at that point of time, because dancing was prohibited before the independence, as all of us know. So it was something very sacred, something very important that we learned this fine art. A few girls from good families. So Geeta was Mr. Krishnan's daughter, and Mr. Krishnan took Geeta and me, I was a young girl of 7 years old, took me to Shanta Rao's place. She allowed him to come to her house because he happened to be income tax commissioner. But when we went, when we talked about dance, then she was a queen, she was the empress. No doubt about it. She would not hesitate. So it was my friend who said that she wanted to learn dance, and Mr. Krishnan introduced and said, "She's my daughter, and this girl is also my daughter, like my daughter. Both of them want to learn dance." So she is a Konkani. She's from Karnataka. In the sense, she would speak Konkani. Also, she would speak Mangalore Telugu, Kannada. So she said, "Ninige yathake dance beku ninige? Why you want to learn dance? Waste my time and your time. You will learn for 2 years, and after that you will get married, then you will get children, then you will get completely drowned into your own family, and my dance, my effort of teaching you is gone. You girls are only so much. I don't want to teach and waste my time. You continue to dance when you are 30, 34, if you are still dancing on the stage, come to me, then I will think of teaching you." She refused. And the first impression I got of dance, or the very first exposure to what dance can be, was that day. I was hardly 7, and huge eyes, beautifully drawn eyes she had, and she had a hibiscus flower on her head with a beautiful juda on the side of her head, and wore one jhumki on the right or left, I don't remember, but she wore only one earring. The other ears she would not wear. Look at this. It is something very rare that we come across somebody like that. And a beautiful ruby pendant. It was this big. Exquisitely made pendant, a beautiful jewelry. And she was like a goddess, Durga, sitting there and holding the fort of dance. She was a crusader for dance which should be presented with utmost devotion and practice. Nothing else than that. And nobody could be a dancer for her. She would just dismiss everybody. And one dancer that she would recognize was Indrani Rahman and say, yes, she is a fine dancer. I mean, whenever I had conversations with her. After that, for many years, of course, we lost touch. Then later, my father is a very great connoisseur of musicians and dancers. So Mr. T.R. Mahalingam used to stay with us those days. And he would share that Shantarao used to be a very good friend. And also, she's S.N. Chandrasekhar, who was a very well-known critic in dance. He was a very good friend of Srimati Shantarao. And he would always visit her. And then he said, no, no, you should again meet her and you should know certain things as to how to present, how to wear jewelry or how to dress up. And when I was learning under Dr. Korada Narsimharov, he wanted me to present Bhama Kalapam before her. Mm-hmm. So we tried our best and somehow Sri S.N. Chandrasekhar was very sweet enough to go and tell her, you have to come for this. And Vice President of India, Mr. B.D. Jatti, was the chief guest. And she was the chief guest there to honor me that day. I was about, at that time, about 20 years, I think. Don't remember the year. And I presented Bhama Kalapam. And she came on to the stage and she said, I'm fairly pleased by your practice. I danced very well. At that very moment, when you see the picture, she garlanded me and she said, this is to see that you continue to dance and I'm fairly impressed by your Bhama Kalapam. She did not say that I danced well. And here is Mr. B.D. Jatti and he is T.R. Mahalingam. And Shantaravji is sitting at the other side. And Natuvanar Buddhadev and my guru, Dr. Korada Narsimharao. This happened, I think it was in Ravindra Kalakshetra, if I'm not mistaken. So after that, she allowed me into her house. I told her, I would like to learn certain things. How are you going to do? How I should present Bhama in a better way? And then she said, the very first thing that a dancer should want or should need is the practice and discipline of practice. Her practice was so disciplined because my neighbor happened to be her vocalist. Shantaratnam. She belonged to a very, very, very intellectual family of violinists and vocalists from Tanjavur. And they were staying next to us. And so whenever Srimati Ratnam went there to practice, to give practice to her, her two children, sons, used to come to our house and they used to stay there. So it was like my home was a babysitting place for her. So we would play around with the sons and all that. But at times, we were not allowed to sit when she is rehearsing. But from the window, we were allowed to watch. This was in Brigade Road House, not in Malleshwaram. Malleshwaram came much later. In Brigade Road House, there was a small window wherein we could stand and watch. Not inside. We were not allowed inside when she was rehearsing. And her rehearsals, like Sunil Bhai was telling now, was very rigorous. The Kathakali exercises that she had learned, she would practice that. Even when I met her, she must have been about 60 or something like that. At that point of time also, she would start off with those Kathakali exercises, her eye exercises. She would put some oil, I don't remember what it was, and then open her eyelids like this and do the exercises of eyelids, which I learned from her. You know, she would hold it like this. She would do that for 5 minutes. I don't know for how long. It would go on. Then she would do only the Natya Rambe position. Then she would jump, sit down in Purnamandi, that is Mulmandi, and jump for a long time. And at some point of time, if she would get into a mood, then she would start the dance. Until then, the orchestra would be waiting there. They were all on payrolls.
Okay.
There would be a mrudangist and there would be a violinist and Mr. Srinivas Murthy, I forgot, the flutist.
Okay.
He would be there. He has toured all over along with her, all over the world. Sunil Bhai, I think you must have known him. Srinivas Murthy, a very great legendary. He used to play for both Indrani Rahman, Yamini Ji, and also. So he would be there, and all three of them would do the. Would be waiting for her when she would start. And when she started, then only the program or the rehearsals would start, and it would go on for any amount of hours. Mm-hmm. This I have seen about two or three times, not more than that. Then one day she invited me to see her paintings along with Chandru. So we went and we had a beautiful journey of watching her painting, beautiful strokes. And you can see that passion for art, the passion for creativity, and that she was born for dancing, one could say that. And she was totally into it. And her conversations or her everything was related to art, creativity, and dance. And that is all. And it was beautiful.
You can show now the film Alariku.
Yehudi Menonji was introducing even Ustad Ali Akbar Khansar and Chatur Lal Ji, who were along with her. We'll just see the two clippings. Okay.
Yes, yes.
From India, music and dance with Ali Akbar Khan and Shanta Rao, introduced by Yehudi Menuhin. Music and dance from India. Next Wednesday, the Museum of Modern Art in New York City is going to open an exhibition that's called Textiles and Ornamental Arts of India. They will show fabrics and folk sculpture, and they will perform music and they will dance. Now, the government of India and the museum and Omnibus have combined to bring to this country two very distinguished artists and their accompanists. And I'm not going to introduce them. I'm going to turn you over to a man who has a passionate understanding of their music and their art, and whom you all know as Yehudi Menuhin.
Ever since my first visit to India some 3 years ago, I've dreamt of the day when I could introduce my friends and my distinguished colleagues to this country, for their music and their dance is something which I'm sure will inspire us all. This is Miss Shanta Rao, one of the leading exponents of the classical dance in India, and her accompanist, Mr. Netappa, who plays the southern drum, which sounded at both ends, treble and bass, and Miss Basanti Rao, who taps these two pieces of wood in an implacable rhythm, which serves as the background, that's right, to the chant sung by Mr. Venkata Ram, and he also uses these cymbals to accentuate the rhythm. And then I'm very pleased and proud to present India's greatest sarod player, Mr. Ali Akbar Khan. This ancient instrument boasts 25 strings. 10 are already quite impressive to a violinist. And these 10 serve to carry the melody, whereas the other 15 are plucked, the 10 are plucked, the other 15 are serve to maintain the resonance of the instrument. This is our brilliant drummer, Mr. Chatur Lal, who plays the northern version of the tabla or drums. This is the treble, and the other drum is the bass. And we come to the indispensable instrument of all Indian music, the anonymous tampura or drone, which maintains the pitch, provides the bass for the melody, and in fact creates a kind of hypnotic mood which seems to liberate the spirit of all players. This is Mr. Gore, who is a pupil and happens to be studying in New York City. The dance, as well as all arts of India, were born in the temples of the ancient Hindu civilization, carrying us back in an unbroken line many, many thousands of years. They were all intended as offerings to the gods. In fact, it would seem unthinkable to an Indian musician, almost up to our very day, to any artist, dancer, or sculptor, to make a livelihood out of his art, to use it for any professional purposes. It is always a labor of love. We will be introduced in our first dance to a classical kind termed Bharatanatyam. This is an age-old traditional dance wherein each gesture is symbolic of a particular state of being, love, fear, pain, or rage. Ms. Shantarao will dance a ritual invocation called Alaripu. The Alaripu by Ms. Shantarao.
Kala guta gata digena tom pa tai tai ta pa
So unusual.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
It's not that the dance. That
thank you so much.
Yeah. Kathakali, Kathakali influence.
Let's see how she's talking about her Kathakali time with the guru and all. No? Yeah.
You see, I was the only girl at the time among so many boys to take to Kathakali. But my teacher said that he will have no favoritism with me. Just because I'm a girl, it does not mean that he has to pamper me. I agree to it. And then my teacher had such a dominating personality and a peculiar way of teaching. And you can't help but go through this routine training at his will. So I did get up at 2:30. I did go through the entire training. But with this exception, I did not go through that sort of oil massage. You see, I had a lighter kind of massage, but not that the boys used to have, lie down like a frog. And, you know, a teacher gets on them and molds their body and the bones in particular fashion. I didn't have that.
What she did have to learn, though, were the extraordinary eye movements. In Kathakali, the strength of the actor's portrayal is in his eyes. 36 different glances, 9 movements of the eyeballs, all convey emotions both violent and gentle. The eyes must protrude as if on stalks. It takes years of practice.
In the beginning, it was just for 2-3 minutes, because you cannot be rolling your eyes all at once for an hour or two. You have to start it slowly. Then you go on increasing the time. Now I can, of course, continue my eye exercise with concentration for even for 3 hours.
Could you demonstrate any eye exercise?
No, I won't.
Cindy to the South Bank, London's Festival Hall and Shanta's final recital. Her program here included dances in the Kathakali style. One that she choreographed herself was in the character of an actual temple dancer who lived 500 years before Christ in the time of Buddha, a courtesan who questions Buddhism. Her name, Ambapali.
I always admired Ambapali. She was a courtesan during the time of Buddha. And I had read a great deal on Buddha. You see, I'm a great admirer of his wisdom and all that sort of thing. So Ambapali, being a courtesan, but a proud person, at the same time a great philosopher and an artist. So naturally, her character, I take to the character only that suits me, you see. Otherwise, I don't touch it. Even Rukmini is a very proud and a strange woman. So Ambapali suits me because she's philosophical, she's a great artist. She never cared for anybody. She was a divine woman. So that suits me so well. So when I sit in a stance to do Ambapali, I really feel I am a courtesan.
There's one more small clipping in the green room also.
My God, the eye exercises.
Mary Magdalene was drawn to Jesus. Ambapali is in the mango grove, and her maids, her sakis, tell her that Buddha is nearby.
You have to imagine that her sakis are informing her that Lord Buddha is at the mango grove among his disciples. And they're so full of praise for Lord Buddha, for his great wisdom, for his great looks and beautiful personality, and that makes Ambapali question, could he be as great as all that?
Yeah, you were mentioning about the eye exercise, please.
What a coincidence that she's mentioned in her talk.
Yeah.
So watch her do that.
Yeah.
Can you show our dance, Mohiniyattam dance?
Ha, we'll show the Mohiniyattam dance.
I thought before that, can we just, some of the nuances that she would practice. Today, very few gurus are practicing that. One guru is Padmini Ramchandran, who has adapted certain beautiful leaps and jumps. It was very unique to Srimati Shanta Rao and Yamini Krishnamurti. These are the only two dancers who would do that leaps. Yeah. Very beautiful way, you know, that gay abandon would be seen, that exuberance would be seen. My student Aishwarya will just show you that little bit how today's Alaripu is and how it can be embellished with the movements of Guru Srimati Shantaram.
Okay.
Can we go online?
Yeah.
On other line?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Ready. On, Mari. Can you do it?
Are you all ready?
Is she seen?
Yeah, yeah. No, if you are ready, then I'll put the camera.
Yes, yes, she's so ready.
We had some.
Okay.
Yeah.
She's ready.
Yeah.
Very good.
Okay.
Yeah. Ready? You didn't jump. Huh?
Next.
Tatei. Now you can see the jump. Tam dit tam kitatakatei tatei kitatakatam dit tam kitatakatei tatei kitatakatam dit tam tei tatei tam 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 dit tatei tatei tam dit tatei Now, if you observe, when she gets up, generally now in the present day tradition, they get up from this Mulmandi to Aramandi. Get up now, Aishwarya, like that. But if you observe the leap and then the jump, do the jump. And when she does tam ditate tate tam ditate tate, the knees come together and then they get up and then she gets up.
Okay,
that is a very unique and very different way of doing it. And another very nice aspect is the mandi adavu, that the continuous mandi adavu that she would do. As I told you, when she would exercise, she would do about 100 mool mandis before even starting. Even at when I watched her at 70, the same mandi adu she was doing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Tam dita te tate 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 tam. These are all very rare movements. If you watch this, this is not used today. Especially the sitting and getting up and extending the feet onto the sides. Do this again, Amma. Tam dita te. This one. This is not used today.
Okay.
This is very unique to her style of dance. Next. And then the mandi adavu, turning and turning back. Tam dita te tate tam dita te tate tam dita te tate tam dita te tate. These are all very, very beautiful steps that we see. We don't get to see these moments now, especially the beautiful leap. That leap, show it again, Aishwarya. Tam dita te tate tam dita. The way she would effortlessly leap is so beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you, Aishwarya ji.
Thank you, Aishwarya.
Thank you, Aishwarya. Very beautiful. The leaf was very beautifully shown. Lovely. Thanks. Very nice.
Sunil ji, yeah.
Mohini Attam.
Yeah, shall we see the Mohini Attam? Yeah.
Yes, yes, let's see that.
Yeah.
She says, could he be a greater personality for having given up the luxury or material things of life? If he's as great as all that is said of him, then why should he die like ordinary men? Here in England, I know they have a deep understanding, may not see the details, but they have some sense of beautiful understanding. That is what matters. I sometimes feel perhaps this is enough because I am given a certain time limit, you see, in a recital. For example, in India, I dance for 3 hours or even 4 hours. It depends upon who invites me, who wants to see more of me. Whereas in England, I'm giving the same recital, maybe 4 items, but I might cut short. I may not give such a great bend to my creative ability, but I'm giving the recital just as I would dance before a very orthodox audience in India.
Oh. There's one more video.
So when she's talking to Margot Fonteyn, the ballerina, when she goes to watch the performance in the, you know, theater, and she meets Margot Fonteyn backstage.
Okay, let's show
that. Yeah, yeah, that's great. Going to
Thank you.
Bapali's meditation on the wisdom of Buddha brought Shanta's performances in England to a close. Her three recitals were a brief but extraordinary insight into the world of Indian dance. On her last...
Thank you so much, Sunil Bhai. We are all very blessed today to watch. Where is the audience? Yeah. Where is the dance? Today, after the pandemic, even that is gone.
I know.
I can't think that era was there.
Devanti had done a great job. Sir, I still
have a question. Thank you so much.
Argo Fontaine, let us see.
Yeah. Bapali's meditation on the wisdom of Buddha brought Shanta's performances in England to a close. Her three recitals were a brief but extraordinary insight into the world of Indian dance. On her last evening, she went to the ballet, the dance of the Western world, to Covent Garden.
then after the performance, a royal reunion with Dame Margot Fontaine.
Altogether beautiful.
So beautiful.
You're so wonderful. I admire you so much.
Thank you so much.
I'm
hope to see
you. I'm very grateful if my dedication to dancing has brought some understanding of classical Indian dancing. I'm grateful, but I'm not expecting too much of life nor art. Even if I'm born again, I believe in incarnation. If I'm born again and again, I only pray that God does not keep me in his heavens, but drop me down on earth to keep dancing, you see.
Wonderful. You can never say this thing. I myself have not seen all these things anywhere. I'm very happy that you took so much help to find out all this footage of the dance of Mohini Attam and all. There are many, many stories about Rao. It's endless stories there because Ram Gopal used to tell about her. He used to dance with her. Because he had danced practically with every dancer. Tara Chowdhury, Shanta Rao, Nalini Sarabhai, Prabodhini Lakhia. And then this is amazing. But what we saw today is something very, very unique. I don't think that the young generation would ever get a chance to see somebody like Shanta Rao. She was one of the very great, unique dancers.
She had the boldness and the conviction that she believed in whatever she presented was the best.
Yeah,
if you see
her
for Kathakali, it is today, if somebody wore something like that, a young dancer wore just the neck piece or just the earrings and danced Kathakali, they would just dismiss it and say, no, you cannot. But she had the conviction in telling that I will do it my way. And my way is the highway.
Oh, I'm very, very happy. Jayavanti, you did a great job. I had not expected this to go so beautifully. And even when I saw second time Mohini Attam show before she goes to meet Margot Fontaine in the ballet, it's wonderful the way she speaks that even from the God, from the heaven, she dropped down. You'd like to become a dancer. That was a great conviction. Prabodhini Lakhia, Chandralekha, they were great friends of Shanta Rao. They admired her greatly. And it was very difficult. I remember that when we were doing the book on Bharatanatyam, and we did not have her good photograph. So she said, no, I must have my photograph there. But we couldn't put her photograph because she sent a legal notice to Mar Publication and Gulkaraj Anand that my photographs are copyright. So we found a solution that Homi Bhabha was a great admirer of Shanta Rao, a great painter, great scientist. So Homi Bhabha's sketch, he took out and put it in her book. She was very pleased with that. When she saw that, she became very friendly. She came to Bombay to receive the award, Raseshwar Award, from Surzigar Samsat. That was the last time we were together in Bombay. But whenever I happened to go to Bangalore, she would always offer me a cup of coffee. I had taken Shantarati Mishra from Singapore, Leela Venkatamudhi with me. We had gone and visited her. I used to call it a palace, wonderful theater building. And you go upstairs, etc., and then the chandelier and all. And she would perform over there. Now, this is not going to be happening ever again. I'm grateful to Chiranjeevi Singh. I'm grateful to Ashok Chatterjee, the trustees, who have taken care of her. Whatever is belonging to her has been taken care of. It's a pity that we have lost the beautiful building. It was
the then Chief Minister Sri Ramakrishna Hegde and the Culture Minister was Jivaraj Alva. They sanctioned this land for her. She built it, telling that it was part, but she did not do it.
But she got the money from Srimati Indira Gandhi and built this building.
Yes.
Now, problem is this, that because there was no trust done by her, there was no will done. There was no signature, but she was very unwilling to sign anything. And therefore, ultimately, Chiranjeevi Singh and other, they managed to get this property saved. And all the belongings, this is with David, the great film actor, David. David and Shankar showed together over here. This Indira Gandhi. She was very fond of her.
She belonged to the illustrious family of freedom fighters, is that right?
Very true. I told about it. And in Bombay, there was one Nariyal Wala, the Parsi couple. They were very fond of Shanta Rao. And they supported her in a very big way. And she had great admirers world over. There is no doubt about her personality at all. I mentioned it earlier that when we are going to Kerala Kalamandalam to do work on Kathakali in 1966, on the way back, we had stayed in the Brigade Road near the post office with Shantara, where my friend Asha Putri, Indira Jaisingh, who is the Supreme Court lawyer, I mentioned this in my article in Narthaki.com. We stayed with her and she used to laugh a lot. And in 71, I believe, when she got the Sangeet Natak Academy Award, I wrote an article in Femina also. And she was very pleased. Later on, we became very friendly. Whenever you go, come and a cup of coffee with me. She would offer a cup of coffee and tell lots of stories. She would show to all the manuscripts. She had a very big collection of manuscripts on tantric art, etc. And a great devotee of tantric art. But very unusual person. I don't think I met any dancer of her stature, of the contemporary from among. She was a unique, absolutely unique. And then we are grateful, Veena, you came and also spoke, because you were very close to her. Also very close to her, next to was Srimati Lalita Srinivasan. She was also next to her, Vimala Rangacha. And she was very well known in, I remember that when Pratibha Prahlad presented one of her festivals, she specially came to see the performance also. She'll come backstage and meet the artist and compliment them. She'll come to see Namini Krishnamurti also and complimented her. She was a generous woman in a way, because she knew good art. And she, when she saw good art, she would go out of her way to bless the young people.
It was not even good, it has to be best. It has to be special.
But then the generosity of her art, her heart was very important.
Yes, yes.
And we are very fond, we are lucky that we were able to meet her, talk to her, be her friend also. And we have a happy memory. We want to thank you, Jayan ji, aapne bada kasht karke kaam kiya hai.
I would like to share one more thing, which is coming back to me. When that familiar article you had written, years later, she was showing that familiar article. And she said, you're all aspiring dancers. He is Mr. Sunil Kothari. If you have to win, or if you have to get a reward of his review or his writing, then you have to take five to six janmas. And today I'm before this legend. Thank you so much. I'm so blessed. I'm just remembering her words.
I'm embarrassed, but she's very good. She was good to me, and we are a good friend also. Despite all our differences, she was a friend of mine and I liked her very much. We are very happy that we knew her well. So, with happiness, we'll thank you. Thank you. And maybe now we can work out some more, programs.
Veena ji, would you like to say something about Shanta ji? Anything?
Any personal matter?
Yes. There are a few points which all of us should learn from. I grew up by watching her, and I would try to emulate her, even in her dressing sense or her sense of sophistication. Because as a dancer, when she went and interacted with the international audiences, she had that class. She had that royal aura around her, and she made dance or Indian culture very, very precious and very sacred, and something which is very, I must say, very high intellect value. Those things, people were able to see it just by her walk or just by her gait or the aura that she presented. So these things we need to inculcate. We need to respect our dance, our profession, in such a way that the audience should not think, oh, it is just another professional show that they do. That attitude, we must exuberate, that exuberance of dance being some of the beautiful things to see or to experience, that is what we must develop. And to develop that, she would say, practice. Hours and hours of practice and dedication. Otherwise, don't dance. She would not use words. She would say, don't become a dancer. Go sell those on the Brigade Road. You can sell those moonpalis. No problem. Okay. So, as youngsters, we would walk on the Brigade Road as college girls, you know, and I and a few dancers who were upcoming then. If we walk on that path, that footpath where Shantarao's ji's house would be there, we would be scared. There would be some kind of, you know, hidden respect and fear, and you know, we would immediately, our back would be straight, and we would be walking with some kind of. It was not fear; it's something. It's an awe. We were all awestruck when she would come to a performance, the way she would dress and the way she would sit. It was beautiful. So we should emulate those things. And the dedication to dance is something which is second to none.
Inaji, fortunately, Indira Gandhi National Center in Delhi, lots of beautiful photographs taken by Sunil Jana. Sunil Jana was a great photographer. Ram Rahman has many collections of it. He knows about her very well.
Yeah,
some photographs are now in the Indira Gandhi National Center. Big collection is there.
Yeah, and some in the some library abroad also. So we'll see the paintings first. The three paintings there.
Yes.
I'm told that Ashok Chatterjee did say that when she passed away, there was a brush in her hand while doing painting. You can see Shantarao written.
And then
he told that she passed away while doing painting, she had passed away with the artist. Now, these are the photographs.
Look at the perfection of the pose. Yeah. Come here, Aishwarya. Watch it.
Extension of pose.
See the stretch. You know, there is so much. And it is not, there is sattvika in it. It is not just one body movement.
Wow.
Beautiful. My God.
Good collection. I'm glad.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah.
The zero figure with all the girls, the Bollywood girls try to see, she has that.
Look at the hands. The hands.
Beautiful, my God.
Just like a lotus blooming or whatever, you know. The hands. Wow.
See, you can feel the music of the flute in those eyes. Beautiful.
Look at that.
Beautiful. See, this comes out of hours and hours of body conditioning. It's not easy. It looks so effortless.
So those were some of the this thing.
Thank you so much. Wonderful.
So it was
some comments have come from Gopika Verma. Our friends have been somebody told her that I am in Bangalore. But I am not in Bangalore, I am in Bombay, and I am in New Delhi. Viraj is in Bangalore, we are in Hyderabad. This is the Kamal of the Zoom.
True. Thanks to the COVID, we are able to see the most positive. Artists have contributed so much to the peaceful and the very nice way of facing this pandemic. Without art, I don't know what the community would have done.
So in these difficult times, I would like to thank Sunil ji. I would like to thank Veenamurthy ji for having come and, you know, shared their thoughts about us remembering Vidushi Shantarao ji, for all the viewers all over the world who has been an icon of culture in the past, and we hope to see you all soon again, whenever this pandemic gets over.
I'm sure Chandrarajji, heavens above, will be very happy today, because once she told me that if you get one line from Sunilji, you are blessed, or you're made. I have that blessing that I can share a stage with him, such a great legend and an icon. That I have
very, legend. I'm very embarrassed. But we are going to have this wonderful discussion also, possibly with our Alkazi, Ebrahim Alkazi, the director of the National.
So, can we session? We'll just see a short Bharatnatyam clip ending. Huh?
Yes.
I might ask her to sing 5 times or 6 times or 8 times or 10 times or 20 times, it makes no difference at all. But the moment I'm beginning to stop translating that particular line, she at once senses it.
So the more repetitive the song, the more invention the dancer displays. And when the singer senses that the dancer has interpreted a complete section of the poem, then they all switch from mere storytelling. The dancer stops making hand and body pictures and beats out complex rhythmic patterns with her bare feet and ankle bells, and the singers chant a sort of scat of rhythmic syllables. The shape of the dance is traditional, but with each performance, new details are improvised. How, I wondered, does the singer know exactly when Shanta wants to change pattern?
I don't look at them and make a sign. Definitely not. If I want to dominate, I jolly well dominate the artist. But here, there's no question of really dominating as such, because there is such a beautiful cooperation between us. Sometimes we go mischievous. Then I just want to challenge the artist on the spur of the moment. And thus we have a very nice time together. They want to show off themselves and I want to show off myself, because sometimes creative things flow from me so fast, so quick.